DJ Leroy, what is going on with you?
Night Watchman. I mean, Hurricane Ida. What can you say, man?
I saw
the images. As you know, I was away. I was in the Green Mountain State.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoyed maple syrup and coffee.
Did you know something that we didn't? They say hell hath no fury like a woman scorns. I don't know who pissed Ida off, but she came in.
Well, let's just say that the other woman, that is, of course, Karen Murray, said, let's get out of Dodge, okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you know what? One thing, I do know that when you were in college, I understand that you were also a DJ playing a number of the hits late night. I understand that you were called the Soul Man. Is that correct?
I was called the Ice Man in college. Soul Man, when that's a movie or something like that, that wasn't me.
Well, needless to say,
I'm the Night Watchman.
that is true. Yeah. One of the things I do know is that certainly during that particular period that we were playing music, listening to music, one of the things we love some of the blue light specials and mm-hmm. some of the, as they say, I remember some of the ballads and grinding music.
I did some all night specials in college. I'm sure there are a couple of kids on the planet that I'm responsible for.
I hear you. Well, you know what? Let's have a discussion about that. What do you say?
Let's bring on the old school. We got the old school coming in. This is going to be a great show. We got two men who have been in the business for a while and have stories to tell, I hear.
Absolutely. So you know what? What we'll do is I'll give them the short little intro and then basically let them take it home, so to speak.
All right.
So one of them is the founder, president, and CEO of So You Want to Be a Star Incorporated, which provides singing classes and artist development workshops. Mm-hmm. That is none other than Mr. Chris Curry. Chris, come on out. Hey, buddy.
Hey, how you doing?
Good, man. Good. So the other, of course, Night Watchman, as I was saying, remember that ballads, those grinding music, mm-hmm. for over 50 years have been a star of the R&B trio, and that, of course, being Black Ivory, Mr. Russell Patterson.
There we go.
Yeah.
Russell, welcome.
Hey, how you guys doing?
Good.
Great.
This is going to be a show of all things, everything, music. So needless to say, Chris, I want to definitely know what actually was the light and spark that went off in your background that drew you to music? Because, of course, seeing your background, you were a member of the legendary group of Ray Goodman and Brown, The Moments, all those things. So do tell.
Okay, let me correct that because I don't want Billy Brown beating up on me. I was not, for the record, I was not a member of The Moments or Ray Goodman Brown, but I performed with them on a number of occasions, Kevin, like Wade Elliott, and a few others when the occasion presented itself.
Okay. Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah, what presented me in music was the old Ted Mack Amateur Hour. I don't know if you remember that.
Yeah.
You know, and so when I was in kindergarten, I used to sing How Much Is That Doggy in the Window? And they thought I was talented enough to put me on that show. And I said, oh, okay, if this is going to get me, you know, the kind of attention in school, you know, because my grades was okay, but it wasn't all that. And the teachers and everyone, I said, okay, I think I'm going to hang on to this. So and that kind of sparked it in me, singing.
Nice. Russell, tell us about your journey.
Well, I always liked to act crazy at family functions. So, but my thing was dancing around. And, you know, when I was like five, I was at a party and I was dancing. And they were like, you know, the older people in the family were like, oh, look at him go. And, you know, that kind of made me think about having that kind of attention. And when I got to be like 11, 12, I went to go see Viva Las Vegas, Elvis Presley and Anne Margaret.
Yes.
And in those days, you could stay and look at the movie over and over again. So I think I looked at it like two times that afternoon. And I said, I want to be like him. So people laugh at me when I say I want to be like Elvis. But hey, he's the one that made me want to sing.
He was the king at the time. Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And I mean, Russell, mm-hmm. over 50 years, Black Ivory. Do tell. I mean,
yeah, did coming you see up on 52 now.
Well, wow. Did you see two dudes, Stuart and Leroy, just kind of like doing their harmonies and say, hey, I like that. I want to be a part of this. Do tell.
Oh, no. The interesting story is that Stuart, Leroy, and three other guys were part of a group called the Mellow Souls. And I was introduced to Larry Newkirk's brother. He was a member of Mellow Souls. And his brother, Todd, started a group called the Shades of the Mellow Souls. So I went to audition for that, and they kind of liked me. But the funny thing is, Leroy was their manager.
Oh, wow.
So Leroy came in, and you know, he was like, wow, you're kind of cool. And they were having one of the issues, like one of the guys left the Mellow Souls, and then there were four. And they were like going around the city doing block parties and talent shows, and they had gotten a little name for themselves. And Larry Newkirk actually wanted to go away to college. So Stuart and Leroy asked me if I would be interested in joining the group once he left.
Okay, beautiful, beautiful. So now you say, Chris, we don't want to get you in any trouble. We do know that you've done some guest performances in other famous notable groups, whatnot. Then tell me about the journey in terms of, so you want to be a star incorporated.
Yeah, that basically began when I noticed a lot of people did not get opportunities or the platforms to be able to showcase their talents. So when I began working with some folk initially, you know, my classes were free. And I basically was giving them the wherewithal to say, everyone has a voice. Everyone can sing. Whether you're out there saying, oh, the world is green, and that's it. Yeah, you're hitting all the wrong notes and everything. You can sing, but wait a minute. I guarantee to make you better. And they couldn't understand that. I said, yeah, better. So after a while, folk were coming. Free didn't work. I learned this the hard way. When you devalue something that you think is valuable and you give it to people free, they don't take it seriously. So once I began charging, then they began attending classes regularly and doing their homework and the whole bit. So what I would do is those who were really getting the lessons, and I must say I'm a fast teacher in terms of voice. I can make anyone better, guaranteed, even to this day. Because there's
even
a whole because there's a psychology that you need to know with regard to your voice. There are certain things, but the key thing in the industry then was, who's your audience? You see, I've had people who were terrible, who couldn't sing, but to their audience, they were fabulous. So we're playing to the audience. So with that in mind, I said, now that I have these folk, I went out myself at 98.7 KISS, and we created, and I was one of the definite creators of the 98.7 World Trade R&B Fridays summer session during lunchtime. It was lunch. And those who did good in class, the incentive was to be able to perform on that stage with a lot of groups like Black Ivory and Reagan and Brown and Melissa Morgan and the OJs. So they were the opening acts. So now everything began moving from there. And one of my prize students is Landau Murphy Jr., who won the 2011 America's Got Talent. He took first place and won the $1 million. Now, let me just quickly do this because I know it's only an hour show. He was singing a lot of songs in class like The Temptations and this and James Brown. He could do it all. But one day when we took a break, he was in there fooling around with a Frank Sinatra song. And I'm like, okay. You're fabulous. So I kind of steered him in that direction. I said, listen, everybody can sing The Temptations. Everybody can sing everything else you're singing. Let's put you in this niche. He got in that niche. And I don't know if you saw that broadcast when he initially was singing in front of them. I don't know if any of y'all remember that. He had the dreads. He looked a little strange. And he was chewing gum. And they told him to take the gum out of his mouth. And then when he started singing Frank Sinatra's song, everyone was blown away. So to this day, he's been traveling around the world doing a lot of those particular songs. So that's one of my pride and joys.
Oh, nice. Wow, that's cool. Yeah, that's I actually came to one of your lunchtime concerts. I saw Joe and Chico DeBarge.
Oh, okay, yes.
That was cool.
I gotta give kudos to Elaine Sawyer from Blue Magic. Her and I was definitely the engine who kind of put that together and sparked it at the radio station, and the rest is history.
Oh, cool.
Nice. And do tell though, Chris, in terms of one of the things, knowing about Summer Stage, but specifically Harlem Summer Stage. Tell us about that, because, you know, there have been a lot of misconceptions in terms of who was the visionary and the creator behind that. So tell
us. I want to set the record straight.
Please.
Before there was even a stage, it was myself, Blue Magic, Elaine, Melissa Morgan. We literally had a boombox that we put on top of a milk crate, and we would go over facing the building. There used to be a wall there, and now it's painted and all. And we would go over there and sing during lunchtime. And we did it, and then Will Brown heard us, and he thought it was a great idea. And he began developing the concept of us doing in front. So then they would bring a stage in, and after he kept moving, we Lorraine Glover got a stage, and we began doing the stage. But as fate would have it, those who were in charge of the situation there in the building saw money. And that was not my driving force. I never accepted a dime from anyone, didn't want a dime, because I just wanted a platform in Harlem to do what I did in downtown at the World Trade Center. So when they saw how everything was going so fabulously, I was eased out. Other folk were eased in. And we'll leave it there. But yes, I am, and you have the record, along with Will Brown, the creators of the Harlem Summer Stage at the 125th Street, Adam Clayton Powell State Office Building. And if anyone has anything else to say against that, they can call me.
All right, we're breaking the stories today.
yes indeed. So Russell, I want to know, because certainly when I was talking to Night Watchman about the ballads, the grinding music, I mean, Don't Turn Around, You and I mean, please, man, then the soundtrack of when I saw someone who I was attracted to, I walk up to them and say, that music comes on, you know what happened. So then there was a little, as I say, a little quiet, a little silence. And then I fast forward, because that was the early 70s. Then I fast forward to 1979. And then suddenly I'm hearing this freaking disco hit, Mainline. Tell us. I mean, that took us into another direction. This is before I started to, you know, wear my wife beater and go hang out at the garage. So do tell us, man, Russell.
Well, you know, back in the day, they like to pigeonhole you into a certain genre of music. So Black Ivory was basically known as, you said, ballad act. Yep. And, you know, we had quite a few hits as a ballad act. And if anybody listened to any of our albums, they'd realize that we've always done all different kinds of music, but the record company only promoted the ballads. And we lost our contract like after a few years, and we were, you know, kind of lost. And we eventually got signed to Buddha Records. And, you know, it was a whole new mindset. Plus the ballad era had kind of gone away to the disco era.
And we
were lucky enough at the time, Leroy had left the group. So Black Ivory only consisted of me and Stuart at that time. And our manager, Lenny Adams, Patrick was our original manager and producer. But Lenny Adams approached Leroy about writing some songs for Stuart and I for the album. And Leroy presented three songs, and one of them was Mainline. And wow. when we recorded it, Buddha thought that would be the one to put out. But the interesting thing at the time was that was when they put it out, that was the time that the disco revolution happened. That's when they were like breaking and burning records in the stadium. And we got caught up in that because Mainline could have been like another, you know, big hit for us. But at that time, radio stopped playing disco. So
Wow.
But luckily, it became a club classic. So now it's
definitely a club banger.
People enjoy.
That's right. Totally. I can definitely say that when I was an undergraduate at Mercy College in Dobbs Ferry, dorming in Yonkers, Mainline was hot.
Yeah.
You know? And especially back then, remember, it's one of the songs where I could show my skills because I was a hustler. So definitely, it's definitely one of the records that I could.
Hustler with the
hustler as in dancing.
I was wondering what kind of hustler. I said, I don't know you like that, Curtis.
You're absolutely right, Russell. I should have clarified that.
That term means different things to different generations.
That is so very true.
Were you a good hustler? Because I never got that at all.
I was a pretty decent hustler. I mean, some of the other, you know, hand movements and, you know, bridges that you create over there. I was, you know, where I had to practice. I practiced literally against a wall. I get my timing. You'd have
by
to see
yourself?
It. That's initially how you start out. But then remember.
See, nobody ever told me that part.
Yeah.
He's got the inside secret.
I'm about to say.
That's why they called him. He was Friday Night Fever. You know.
I mean, certainly we do know in terms of what you call one of the things that happens in Harlem, and as despite some of the difficulties, is Sunday Sermon. at Sunday Sermon. Is where you might even see a clip that Stormy Norman has of me and one of the hustle partners. Shout out to Linda Walton that we
really?
Made.
Okay.
Yes, made some history there. So yes, definitely. And please do tell me, Chris, the relationship and some of the stuff that you were doing there at Kiss FM.
Yeah, you basically when Isaac Hayes came to town. And they needed to kind of put him in a format. The very first time, let me back up. My introduction at Kiss basically was because I wrote the theme "Kissing You With Our Classic Love" that everyone recorded, including Black Ivory. So that jingle kind of vamped everything up. So Isaac comes to town. On that Monday, on that Thursday, they wanted to have an event for him. Okay, so they couldn't think. So Toya contacted myself and Traviso Milner to kind of put together a party for him. And once we put that together, you know, with what was that, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, 3-day notice, it was fabulous. And Isaac was so impressed that now I'm his buddy, his sidekick, travel with him. Africa, set up a school over there and begin doing a lot of music with and learning from him in terms of music composition.
Nice. Man, oh man. Because sometimes at Night Watchman, we certainly do remember some of them jingles, man, were like sometimes even more memorable than the actual song, you know?
Right.
Yeah. Well, you had to remember them because they played them like 3 times an hour.
That is true.
Yeah, they played that song so much. I said, wait a minute, you know, how can I get credit for this? And that's a whole nother story about that also. I'm like, dang, I should have gotten some publishing on that.
Let me see. The inevitability in terms of groups, group dynamics, sometimes becoming frayed. Okay. What do you recall in terms of the relationship that you had with your as I say, group mates at the Black Ivory? Were there any tensions, any frictions, or did you just suddenly wake up one day and just said, you know what, I want to also try to do this on my own? Maybe I should take my music in a slightly different direction. Russell, tell me about that.
You talking about currently or in the past?
No, in the past. Oh,
okay. Well, we were together for long enough to be to the point where we were like family, and mm-hmm. there weren't really any like major tensions that would make us, you know, like fight or argue or anything like that. But Leroy actually left the group in 1977 because our manager at the time didn't like the idea of expanding. He was one of the people who wanted to keep us in a certain way. And Leroy wanted to branch out and do different types of music. He wanted to write for other people. He mm-hmm. wanted to produce. And our manager basically told him, no, you just do what you're doing right now. Just sing. And wow. Leroy, you know, he went through like a bit of, you know, it was a dilemma for him because, you know, he liked being in Black Ivory. Mm-hmm. But he knew he couldn't stay in Black Ivory and it continued the way it was.
Right.
So he left. And mm-hmm. There was no tensions between us. And at that point, Stuart and I, you know, we contemplated whether we needed to get another member. Mm-hmm. And we both said no, because luckily Stuart could sing the songs.
Gotcha. Stuart had right.
a very similar voice to Leroy, so he could sing in that high voice. And, mm-hmm. you know, just the two of us went out and performed as Black Ivory for, I think it was like 3-4 years mm-hmm. before, mm-hmm. you know, we lost our next deal and we didn't have a deal for a while.
Gotcha.
But a lot of times in other groups, I've learned it's all about ego.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Chris.
People think they're better than the next person, and you know.
Wow, Chris. Let me hear a further comment on this.
Yes, because interesting enough, over the years, you know, and I've been doing this for over close to 60 years. You know, starting out with Frankie Lyman and Teenagers up in Harlem and hanging around with them and seeing how at that time Morris Levy, who supposedly, and I know he didn't, wrote with Frankie Lyman on Why Do Fools Fall in Love, but Morris didn't write any songs. Morris could barely speak, but he knew the business. But Sherman Garnes, who I was very close with, who was the bass singer, you know, they were so impressed with receiving, you know, I never forget, $10,000 that first time they got, which they thought was a lot of money. And I guess it was at that time. Everyone else went out and bought Cadillacs. He was the one person who went and bought a house in St. Albans, Queens. And they would walk down the street, you know, instead of being concerned about money. And I'm sure Russell can attest to this. A lot of times they weren't making the money they should have been making on the road, but they were so endeared to their name being in headlights, people recognizing them, people giving them certain gifts backstage, the women and everything else. So they didn't keep their eye on the dollar. But their egos, going to the point that Russell made, their egos was just so inflated that even some people that I know today, to this day, 2021, who in some of those 70s groups, they still talk about, oh, do you know who I am? I don't know. So yeah, it was ego. And I'm sure Russell can speak more to that also.
I don't know nothing about an ego.
No, not you. Different people that you run across. Not
I don't
you.
Know nothing. No.
Okay. He's never seen it. Okay. Leave me out here.
Everybody in the industry is nice.
Okay. What did it say? Those who know don't say, and those who
yes,
say don't.
Okay.
Wow.
No,
wow.
But it has been an issue for a lot of the groups, especially from our era, because you know, you in our era is usually like, you know, 3 to 5 members. And you know, people who aren't related, who are related, at times they don't get along. And then, you know, things just happen where they break up, unfortunately. Because some of these groups, I mean, like right now, for years, people have been wanting the original Blue Magic to come together. And it just hasn't happened.
Right, right.
But that's that sibling stuff. That's, I mean, it is, it can be ego, but it's also, you know, the brothers in that family dynamic. But if they got together, they would be like rich.
Oh, Lord. Yes, yes, yes. And Curtis, to your point, the one person that I know that affected, and it hurt me to my heart because her and I were so close, was Mary Wilson of the Supremes. And there were so many times when her and Diana, you know, should have been able to work things out, but on Diana's part, she didn't. And Mary was the one that kept the name Supremes going. So, and it just hurt that, you know, all she needed was just one tour with Diana, just one. It would have. But ego, I mean, okay, I'll leave that alone. But
I hear you, man. I hear you. Well, I guess, you know what? Certainly we do know when it comes to the whole sampling, because we certainly know at the particular era that you're coming out, and you mentioned it, Russell, you know, disco was, quote, unquote, dying. Rap, hip hop was another genre that was coming onto the scene, and it was starting to ramp up more. And of course, we see in hip hop and rap, we see what sampling, okay, big time, of a music from your era. Please give me some thoughts on in terms of the state of, let's say, hip hop, the utilization of sample. Has that been a benefit or definitely a hurt to the business? I'll let both of you guys go. Russell.
Oh, okay. I don't know if it's been detrimental to the business because it was just a new generation expressing themselves, in my opinion. And we've actually benefited because Raekwon, he sampled one of our B-sides, and that's been his biggest hit.
Nice.
He's from Wu-Tang. And Nas has sampled a couple of our songs. He sampled You and I. And he was nominated for a Grammy for that song. So I don't think it's been detrimental. It's just that they were doing what they felt, you know. And the thing is, a lot of them really appreciate the music, which is interesting because our era was called classic soul music. Doo-wop is like all over the world.
Right.
Hip-hop is all over the world. Classic soul is basically like swept under the rug. Nobody's, you know, like the classic soul artists, we still like basically doing the chitlin circuit. Whereas the doo-wop artists and the hip hop people are, you know, mainstream. So that in that respect, it's been detrimental to us that we're not acknowledged. But people love our music, which is really crazy.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. I was thinking about me grooving on some Q-Tip sample of one of your songs too, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Nice. Chris, tell me.
Oh, no, yeah, Q-Tip's the one that got nominated, but Nas got nominated, too.
Right, exactly. Tell me your thoughts, Chris.
Yeah, two points in that particular situation. Sampling basically got started because these folk were definitely wordsmith with no music background, so they needed the music that was already out there in order to utilize their skill set, which was words, ability to utilize words. Now, it definitely was a benefit to those who wrote the songs because of the publishing and the writing, because initially James Brown was against them sampling his music until he saw his royalty checks and he actually said, do it. You want to sample anymore. Okay, so that was a fabulous situation. Now, Russell, to your point about people not acknowledging your music, if they took all of the music of the 70s off every radio station in the world, Do you realize there would be no real music format? And that's including KISS, WBLS. If they just erased them and wanted to play just the music that people are coming out with now, they would have no music. So right, they're acknowledging your music, but they're not doing it in a sense where you will be able to monetize that particular component.
Right, that's true.
And chances are, they don't even know that they're acknowledging it. They're just saying, we can use this. This is great music. We're going to fill these slots with this music. And case closed, without looking at the artists who can definitely use that in these years.
You know what, a Night Watchman, certainly thinking about some of the films that talked about the record industry, like Cadillac Records and some of the others. That was a time when literally, if you weren't being ripped off by your agent, or the manager, whatever, you could actually make some coin and you could live, right? But now that the business has gone to streaming platforms, is that still possible to make some money, or must you be on the road touring?
Russell, me?
Yep.
I don't even think you're making any money touring. I mean, if you think about it, there's a lot of acts who are major and they doing more endorsements because you're not really making any money in the industry from streaming. Please, wow. I remember like at least 6 years ago, I'd gone to a studio with somebody and they were talking about 5 years before that, albums and CDs were selling to like, you know, 30 million and that kind of thing. That conversation 5 years ago, they said the biggest artist sold 5 million copies, and that was Rihanna. The music industry, after all the record companies went, they just they changed our way of making money anyway from them. Not that, you know, a lot of us did get Cadillac Record. But now it's a whole different animal. You gotta like sell alcohol, or you gotta have a clothing line, you know.
Wow. Chris, go ahead.
Yes, that's interesting in terms of what Russell said, because that definitely is true, and it's bothersome, because I was just throwing a lot of stuff out, and I have some contracts from all the concerts I used to do at Lincoln Center, Madison Square Garden, and other places, along with M. Martin Hall and Teddy Powell. And looking at the contracts and the amount, some of those groups from the 70s are still making that same money in terms of the contracts we had back then in the 70s and the 80s, which is absolutely criminal.
Yes.
Criminal.
Wow.
Because Russell,
yes.
if you tried to book your group with some of the prevailing wages that you feel you should make, a lot of promoters will still try to say, no, this is all we're going to give you. And sinfully, you know, a lot of promoters I know are still trying to pay groups from their 70s $2,500, $3,000, which is a crime.
Remember we did a show before the pandemic that a promoter we had worked with before, and when I told him what our amount was, he says, when did you make that? And I'm like, well, you paid me that the last time we worked for you. And he's like, really? So yeah, they don't really feel that we're worth what we think we're worth. And actually, Black Ivory is the only group with all the original members from back then. And, you know, for them, that's a selling point for them, but that's not a way that we can make money, extra money, which it should be.
So any comments on the streaming platforms?
I personally think it works for some people who perhaps are not as old as we are, perhaps, I don't know, because they have followers. Because wow. I have three CDs that I did called Jamming on the Mic with Chris Curry and Friends, and I have all the names that you could think of on there. And they're speaking about, well, now you have to build up an audience for this. You have to do this. You have to pay for this. And you could get 10,000, I mean, is that the correct term, streaming, or 10,000 views? And but I mean, if it's not organic, if it's not organic, it doesn't mean anything. So how do you get your music out there? Well, I think it comes back to my other point. You have to now have your own audience. Who are not going to buy into your situation. Like, you have this podcast here. If you don't have a certain amount of people who are going to watch you, will you be able to survive, or does it really matter to you?
Gotcha. Russell, same thing. Streaming platforms.
Well, what Chris said is correct. It's like harder for people to get their music heard, because they're so, now that the record companies are gone, I mean, music comes out, you can get like 2,000 songs, new songs that come out every day.
Right.
Everybody's streaming, and you have to have your own machine to promote your music. Like right now, I put out my CD, the first solo CD I put out this month. I put out two singles from in the last 2 years, and I didn't make a dime, really, because I don't have that machine behind me to promote it to where people will be aware of it.
Gotcha. Russell, back to you. In terms of that solo project, now, this, of course, happening 2020 during COVID, the lockdown. Tell us the experience and what made you, motivated you to get in the studio and just, you know, grind and do it and put it out. Because I've heard a couple of the singles there. Yeah, you're hearkening back to a time that I hold dearly. So tell us the journey.
Well, it wasn't a grind, because I started doing the CD in 2010.
Wow.
Yeah. I started doing it, and then Black Ivory, we wanted to do our own CD. So three of the songs that I had initially started for my CD, I put on the Black Ivory Continuum CD, and then I really had to start all over again after that.
Wow.
But yeah, over the years, it's been like a grind as far as a labor of love for me, because I've always wanted to do my own, you know, product. Mm-hmm. Outside of Black Ivory, especially because Black Ivory was known for a certain thing. And, you know, when you're in a group, you have to, like, go through the other guys as to what type of music you want to put out.
Right.
And I started doing it. I said, you know, I'm just going to put out things that I like and songs that I've been working on over the years. And I'm happy with it.
Well, let's play one of those songs from the new album.
Cool.
Yeah, I like this song that you did called Spain, and you want to just give us a little bit of background about it before I play it.
Well, Leroy Burgess and I wrote. He gave me the track, and I just went home and it just had like a Latin feel to it, and I came up with the idea of Spain. And I thought about Lionel Richie and his kind of, you know, how he would do things. Because the song actually reminds me of like a Lionel Richie song.
Right, like
All Night Long. Or something like that.
Well, not that one, but.
But it's got, yeah. Well,
it has like hello kind of thing where you're talking about the girl and stuff. So.
Right.
Words and, you know.
Yeah.
And the idea of him meeting her in Spain and them falling in love.
Nice. All right, so
let's hear it.
Okay.
It was when the sun was going down and night falls into view. There were others all around, but all I could see, there was you all alone in the night. your body into a sway. I knew right then in my heart that I'd remember. Spain, dance for me. Dance tonight, just the way you did when we first fell in love. Spain made me fall all over again. That's the way you did night with the Spain. How could I know that you would be the one seducing me under the stars, looking oh so beautiful, moving to a Spanish guitar. He strums off into the night, yeah. Making love until the dawn, and before the morning light, I knew I loved you. Spain, dance for me. Dance tonight, just the way you did when we first fell in love. Spain, make me fall all over again.
And Night Watchman.
Just the way you did the night we met in Spain. I guess you knew. Right,
yes.
Star that you become the rhythm to my heart. Dance for me.
Oh. We got a nice little bridge here. Okay. Good.
Good music.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Very good.
But it's also we see the arc, you know, because it's good, but it's not Black Ivory, it's not Mainline, it's you know, we see the progression.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, I wanted to do stuff that I felt was contemporary now.
Mm-hmm. Or that
some younger demographics might like.
Right.
Absolutely.
Well, that's where you get the streams from.
Mm-hmm. Right. There you go.
All right. What's the name of the album?
It's called Love Life.
Okay.
Yeah,
and
Love Life.
Where can people find it? There we go.
Okay. Wow. See, now think about it. Night Watchman, back in the day, no one knew about branding to this level. In order to be competitive and relevant, you have to know branding. So that was excellent, Russell. In terms
that's my new uniform. If you see me in Harlem, that's what I'll have on.
Okay.
Now what's criminal about all that? And I proposed this to Kiss before they went out of business, and WBLS not long ago was to create a time period on their station where they would play new music by all the classic artist groups that had new music. And I thought it would have been ingenious, because they still had their fans, their fan base, their followers, like the song Russell just played. I mean, why couldn't that be in a regular rotation on a format that could perhaps be on, let's say, a Sunday or a Saturday evening, where they're playing new music by classic groups? Well, got shot down.
Wow.
And there's a lot of classic, what you call classic R&B groups from the 70s, that have new music that they would like to have on the air.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I miss Hal Jackson. Hal Jackson was amazing. Oh,
sure.
And Frankie Crocker. Frankie Crocker didn't care what the program director said. He's like, I'm gonna play my music, whatever I want to play. And that's one of the issues I have with like urban radio, yes, is that they're not owned by urban people. They're not trying to promote Black artists anymore. It's all about pop music. Mm-hmm. That's why BLS is still playing stuff from like 20, 30 years ago.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a serious discussion. So tell me this, in terms of, let's say, artists of today, some of the young bucks out there, Who do you think is you know what, they have a good product, good talent, whatever. I'd like to maybe experience more of their style. Who would you say? Who would you say is right now up there?
Well, go ahead, Chris. Maybe you have some people you met.
Who I really like, even though they put it together nicely from our music of the past, is Bruno Mars.
Okay. I thought for somebody I knew, sick, silky soul. Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay.
Yeah. Taking from the past and making it palatable to this generation, because they're not familiar perhaps to the degree that we are of that music and the rhythm sections and the vocals. And he's making it.
Yeah.
Russell, yeah. Uh-huh. Watch this. Wouldn't you be happy if you could make $500,000 per gig, like Bruno?
I'm like,
give me one gig.
But wait, I'm bugging out about Stephanie Mills making $40,000 a gig. I'd be happy to get that.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Yes.
Russell, is that a recent development in terms of Stephanie? Because she had disappeared off the charts for a minute. Go ahead.
She did disappear, yeah. And she hasn't had anything new record-wise that I know of. But she worked with this promoter I knew a couple of years ago, and I think she's making like $20,000 a gig. Right. And, you know, in the last couple of years, she's had a resurgence as far as fans. And yes, she raised her price. But wow. Yeah, $500,000 would be, you know, I'll take it.
Yeah, one gig.
Yeah, I'll take that.
And you're right, Chris. Let's say Bruno Mars and also Anderson .Paak are great artists in their own right, individually.
Yes.
But now, as a matter of fact, what's it called? My wife, I guess I'm going to call her my production assistant, and say, I inadvertently said Silky Soul. No, it's Silk Soul. Thank you, dear. Oh, Silk Sonic.
I'm going to say.
Thank you, dear. Night Watchman, you need to help me out here.
No, you're on your own. You're not stepping in that one.
Yeah, but to the point, from a cultural standpoint, during those times, the majority of the artists were doing songs that was romantic, that spoke about relationships, that spoke about positive relationships, that didn't say anything that was degrading about their women or mothers or daughters or anything. And our songs, you know, was just that healing. I mean, Try a Little Tenderness, you know, Solid as a Rock. I mean, just to name a few, Special Lady. I mean, we spoke endearingly about our women. Today, a lot of the music, not all of it, you know, speaks so derogatory about women in general and Black women in particular.
Yes, you're right. Certainly, we do know during the rap era that we heard a real backlash in terms of the phraseology, in terms of referring to women, as you mentioned, Chris. Now, R&B, I really haven't heard them deviate much from that. I mean, certainly we do know with Belle Biv DeVoe, we had, you know, Poison. We had Jamie doing his thing in terms of Blame It on Alcohol and what's that other thing in terms of Gold Diggers. We certainly do know. But so you're saying that there is some hope in terms of the positive messages that some conscious artists are doing in terms of the homage to women, that we're seeing a resurgence of that now. What would you say, Russell?
Well, I don't really know, because actually the R&B artists that are out these days are mostly on the internet. So we don't have access to them as on a regular basis. But I don't think that, you know, I think being derogatory to women is not something that we do regularly these days. But my problem with what's going on right now is us using the N-word like it's you know, it's some kind of wonderful thing. We're not, you know, I don't see any other group of people used a word that was used negatively towards them in song. Right.
Yeah. So
that for me is a problem.
That definitely, Chris.
Yes.
Yeah. Do tell us your thoughts in terms of let's say this. Well, the using of the N-word in songs, is it necessary? I mean, haven't we not moved beyond that? And to your point, Russell, you're right. What people use this negative word has so much negative energy. You keep that stuff alive. That's crazy. But yeah,
yes.
Chris, tell us your thoughts in terms of, let's say, messaging out there.
Well, it's systemically planned. Those who are in charge of the music that you hear on the radio and is being directed to one, a certain group of people, regarding a certain group of people, to the population, and it kind of keeps us in that space that is negative and that's constantly keeping us at odds with each other. Now, we're allowed to say that, and they're allowed to play it on the air.
Mm-hmm.
Let Chris Curry go and create a song about, yeah, them damn Jews and them Jews and they were stealing, you know. First of all, it won't even get played on the air. I'll be sanctioned. There will be a lot of things against me. Now, even if another ethnic group came out and decided they want to say something against their own ethnicity, they're not going to play it on the air. It won't get that far. So this is just systemic damage once again. And as Russell says, you know, it shouldn't be allowed. And I don't foresee what can happen unless I have no answer to that.
Well, we have to stop supporting people who make those records.
Yes, I agree.
Once we stop buying records that have that word in it, then, you know, they'll stop using it.
Russell, you're absolutely right, because remember, it's all driven by the market.
Yes.
So if you consume that, that's the product that they'll continue to put out.
Yes.
For sure. So Night Watchman, I'm hearkening back to your days as a DJ yourself. I mean, these were the particular artists that you would be playing.
Absolutely.
What do you remember about those times?
Well, what I like and what I particularly like about Russell's new music is it's about song construction. You know, the songs, they have bridges, they have key changes. All the things that made the music so great, a lot of that is missing even from the, you know, so-called pop and R&B. A lot of times they just stay in the same groove for the same song, as opposed to taking you on a journey. And so, you know, the music of the era of these gentlemen is about storytelling, is about taking people on a journey. There's usually a subtext and message. And, you know, the groups of that time, you know, even, you know, they had fun songs. They had songs that were about partying, but there was always also message songs. And so every group that had a party song also had a message song. And so it's and the music, that's why the music is so so important to us, because it became the fabric to our lives. So that even though, you know, there was always the hot, you know, there was the hot banger, party song, there was the slow grooves, but in between those, there was a song or two that had a message that we needed. You know, you think about Marvin Gaye, who I feel like Marvin Gaye spoke to the black man's existence in America in a way that no one else ever had. He talked about what's going on. He talked about mercy, mercy me. He was talking about the ecology back then. We're still talking about it now.
Right.
So, there's power in music. And I think what Chris was referring to is the fact that the power has been usurped. that music, we haven't lost the power of the music. It's just that we don't get the powerful music on the air anymore. And I think that that's the issue that we've been facing.
Yes.
Okay, Curtis, since we only have a few minutes, can I take about 30, 40 seconds to say something?
Go for it, my brother. Go for it.
Yeah, to the point that the gentleman was speaking about, I have quite a few message songs out there. If you want to hear them, you can go to Chris Curry Music, V-E-V-O, on YouTube, and you'll see all my videos regarding the violence in the streets, stopping the violence. I wrote a song on When the Shoe's on the Other Foot, which deals with a young man who thought it was funny when he was shooting at a crowd and gets home and find out that it wasn't so funny when he found out he shot his own mother. The other song I did is Orphan's Prayer, about a young man who's walking around the streets asking people, can he be part of their family? So it goes on and on. So if you like to experience what I call the resurgence of my mentors, you know, going back, like you say, Marvin Gaye and Curtis Mayfield and Stevie Wonder, and Tom Bell, you know, go to my YouTube channel, Chris Curry Music, V-E-V-O, and you'll see all of the songs that I've written with a message in the music, a positive message in the music.
Beautiful, beautiful. Great. Russell, now, give us your stuff. Where should folks go to check out your stuff?
Album is being promoted on bandcamp.com. And you can listen to it if you like there, and you can purchase it there. And the singles I put out there on YouTube, they're on Amazon, iTunes, and CD Baby. So they're out there.
Beautiful, beautiful. Night Watchman, you know, we're probably going to have to do a little follow-up on stuff like this. You know this.
Absolutely. I mean, this has been a great show. We appreciate you guys sharing your time and your experiences with us. And
thank you for having me.
Yeah, and I think we got to take it out, you know, with that club classic.
Yeah.
So you've been listening to Soul Lounge Primetime on WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem. You can find us also live on YouTube and on Facebook on Monday nights at 8 o'clock. We're on WHCR on Monday nights at 7 o'clock. Thank you for listening. Please tune in and please support these brothers. They're still out there, still making the good music, and we love them.
Support classic R&B music. Yay!
Support independent artists, too.
Ah, there you go.
Yes.
Gentlemen, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You got it.
Good to see you, Chris.
All right, you too. Still waters run deep.
Gentlemen, thank you, guys.
All right.
See you.
Take care.
Take care.
Uh-oh. I'm so addicted, I just can't get enough.